Welcome back, everyone, to the Progressive Patriots. It's just going to be me once again. Holidays coming up, you know how it goes. So today, it is December 18th. It is just after 1930, Arizona time. So, you know, the old thing, like, who knows what will have happened by the time this reaches your ears. Actually, one really breaking note, I want to say maybe 30 minutes ago, there was a 6.2 magnitude earthquake in western China, in the province. The province is known as Gansu. Not a lot of news about it otherwise. Man, like, holy shit. It's like minus 14 degrees Celsius or just under 7 degrees Fahrenheit when the earthquake hit. So, holy fuck. Only reports right now are about like water lines, electricity, power lines, roads, rails, and other telecommunications equipment are damaged. But, like, that's all I got. So, let's get right into the news here. I'm going to start with one in Korea, on the Korean Peninsula. So, earlier today, the USS Carl Vinson, an aircraft carrier, and the USS Missouri, a nuclear-powered submarine, arrived in, I think the port is Busan, and the very friendly neighbors to the north referred to they called this war moves. Not all right. So, in response to that, they launched an intercontinental ballistic missile, commonly called ICBM. The missile that they launched, it was called Hwasong number 18, and they called this a demonstration of their nuclear readiness. Their exact phrases being their toughest counteraction and their overwhelming strength. Just those are two little snips. The launch, the state news, I think the only news that they get, they called this a clear signal to the hostile forces who have fanned up their reckless military confrontation hysteria against us, essentially. I think saber rattling is a phrase that everybody fucking uses for the Korean Peninsula situation. But in this case, the intended audience of the saber rattling specifically was us. That is the United States. There is, based on its how, where it was launched, its trajectory, how long it was in flight, which was 74 minutes, the estimated range of that missile, if the conditions were ideal, would be somewhere in the neighborhood of 9,300 to 9,500 miles. That puts it, you know, like smack in the middle of the U.S. if they so wanted. Not the best, you know, not the most wonderful news to start the week with, but one thing I can personally attest to, I was stationed in Korea for 2 years. I can say that anytime the U.S. does anything, it doesn't matter what, they call it an act of aggression, and like the Americans are trying to instigate war with their like war games or whatever they want to call it. Like a humanitarian aid ship that's like a military marked vessel could arrive and they would call it a war move or something. It's one of those situations I like to use just in my day job. I encounter this a lot where people freak out about stuff. I mean, rightfully so. You know, things shouldn't be going haywire at any point. They should be operating as they should, right? But the thing is, like, there's levels to it, which, to me, that's the perception I have of these sorts of situations is, what's the severity? What's the impact? What is the magnitude, the significance of this particular problem? And there are types of people who call everything like a my fucking dick's fallen off emergency, like the running around with chicken running around with the head cut off, just completely hysterical over fucking nothing. And this, I don't expect that North Korea does this to try to lull us into a sense of complacency. I really don't think that they have that level of sophistication of thought behind their actions. But I mean, if somebody like a uniformed person flies to Korea and you call that a war move of unprecedented level of provocation. Like, if everything's an emergency, nothing is an emergency. Like, seriously, calm the fuck down. But I don't know. I think it might be a little bit of that Napoleon syndrome. It's unfortunate that the Korean people have to pay the price for a leader's insecurities, but whatever. This is not the first time they've launched a missile. I don't know how many it's been now, and they've all been some kind of like demonstration of our ability to strike back. Okay, we got it. How about you don't launch this one, and the money you would use to build another one, why don't you like get people food? Because I think that's what they need. The gene pool of North Korea has been altered, significantly altered, because of the separation that North Korea puts upon itself from the rest of the world. I think South Koreans are somewhere like 3 to 5 inches taller on average, men and women. It's fucking wild. I know that at the DMZ, the South Korean military, they post up, like, their guards that they post up are fucking like beefcakes, you know what I mean? Like, they're like at least 6 feet tall. They're fucking jacked. And so it's like, that's their, I want to say, miniature or like a subtle show of force. Is like, dog, like, you guys didn't even have dinner yesterday, not because you didn't want to, and like, old homeboy over here has a protein shake with more caloric value than everything you eat in a week. So you sure you want to go down that road? That's what it looks like to me. I just thought that was funny. All right, out of Korea, and we are in, this one is, it's still in Asia. It pertains to China and Vietnam. This one was, I thought, when I first saw the headline, I'm going to admit, I was a little bit taken aback, like, oh, fuck me, like, this, that's not good. But you'll see why I'm not as alarmed as I get through this. But so 3 months ago, Joe Biden went to visit Vietnam, one of those, you know, building partnerships, cooperation, friendship, whatever, diplomatic ties. Last week, Xi Jinping, eternal president of China, he concluded his visit to Vietnam. So the official statements that have come out of that visit are notably increased cooperation, just in general, but notably in matters of defense and security. The defense cooperation is logistics, supply chain, and intelligence sharing. This is a key one that I'll be getting. I'll be talking more on later, in just a second. But so when Biden visited 3 months ago, by all accounts, it was a really successful, fruitful trip. We the U.S. secured commitments from Vietnam to offer cooperation on health, like healthcare. Advancing healthcare technologies, education, and advancing technology in education, and just other sectors of trade in general. So a spokesperson for the embassy, not the ambassador, but the embassy spokes, whatever, our relationship with Vietnam is not about any third country. So it... Despite how this might look on the surface, it does not seem that anybody's really concerned, overly concerned anyway. Right, so the intelligence part. That was what had initially worried me, like intelligence sharing between the two, because China's like, there's no secret. They're a bit of an adversary. So the professor of Southeast Asian politics at the National War College, which if you know what it is, so there you go. So he said, Zachary Abusa is his name, the emphasis on hostile forces, in quotations, is not a surprise. China's leaders always whisper this in Vietnam's leaders' ears. But don't overstate the bilateral cooperation between them on this. They won't be sharing intel. So you might think, maybe you study them, but like, what the fuck do you actually know about them as people? Because they tried to... I expect what he means, like the emphasis of hostile forces is... like Western attempts to subvert their own their independence and their whatever system of government they would like to have based on the will of their own people, which I mean, historically you kind of can't argue there, but so with that in mind, this next one is from Raymond Powell. He was formerly an attaché to the U.S. Embassy in Vietnam. I'm not entirely sure, like, air attaché. I don't exactly know what that means, to be honest with you, but I'm going to assume that it's important. Regardless, he is now currently he's a faculty at Stanford, and he's the head of the Project Miyoshu. It's studying the South China Sea, like the political landscape around that. So he had this to say: there is always a distinction between Vietnam's diplomatic pronunciations and its actual security concerns. Hanoi will continue to look for the safe ground between placating Beijing's political expectations and the threat China poses, particularly to its South China Sea position. So between those two, I'm like, deferring to the experts a little bit here. They've been studying this for quite some time, so they probably have a good idea of what they're talking about. And I mean, we can continue to observe the situation from the outside just as much as they can. I think the suggestion that they're making here, and is probably why nobody's really concerned about this, is because, well, they know what China's up to, and despite all the sweet as honey, Winnie the Pooh, despite all the sweet words that they exchange, actions speak louder than words, and in recent history, we have continued to be a consistently good partner with the Vietnamese, while the Chinese have been, it seems like they're the ones trying to do the subverting now. So at the very least, they're doing that in the oceans with, you know, like commercial fishing and all that. So that has been a problem for quite a long time. And China's getting more brazen about just laying claim to the whole thing for no fucking reason. So what are you going to do there? Let's move on here. We are in Ukraine. This one's kind of quick, but the chief of staff for the army, General Valery Zalushnil, I think I got that right, he made a comment, I think it was like kind of an aside that ended up getting picked up by the media. From what I can gather, that's how this went down. But he made a comment that the front line was starting to become a stalemate. It was moving into that sort of war of attrition kind of thing, kind of situation. And pretty soon after that, the president, Vladimir Zelensky, he denied it. Like, that, no, that's not the case. So the general today in some kind of official statement, when asked, he pointedly said that no, not a stalemate. But it, as in another one, I think a senior army official speaking on condition of anonymity said that troops at the front line are facing pretty harsh shortages in supplies, so that they're having to scale back offensive operations. This is one of those situations. This is I want to say it was the first episode we ever did for Worldwide where Tasha pointed out, like, this situation, this is a precursor to what could be a lot more situations like this, but they will be much more violent. In particular, we talked about China taking Taiwan. And so, yeah, like, if we stop helping Ukraine, like, we don't have to go and actually do anything ourselves. But, man, like, if we don't help them, like, Russia's going to take it back. And I say take it back, meaning taking it back to the Soviet Union when they owned it. As far as I know, which I will look into more for the domestic episode that I'll be doing tomorrow. But as far as I know, Congress fucking dipped out for the holidays. Fucking cocksuckers. God damn it. Fuck, because I was about to say this. I know, last I heard, Congress was withholding aid to Ukraine. It was conditional that there needed to be improved security at the U.S. border with Mexico. I mean, given what the situation is, like, I find myself day by day disagreeing less. Like, dog, something needs to be done here. Like, the whole razor wire and death buoys that Texas had set up, like, no, fuck no. I would prefer to do nothing than to do that. But we can't not do anything about this. So I'm going to try to put on my little radical centrist fucking hat and say, like, dude, this is a time we need to compromise. And I'm going to be like, I'm finding myself not able to disagree not nearly as much just as the situation continues to worsen. Yes, these are people. Being a human being is not that they're human beings are not illegal in and of themselves. I don't believe that one bit. But at the same time, like, things as they are cannot continue. And if we want to help, I want to help Ukraine very much, because I understand the greater, the grander scheme of things if we don't. But at the same time, like, we do have to do something for ourselves as well. Because, I mean, like, it's not like Mexico is going to invade or anything. That would be stupid. Because, you know, like, we're pretty good buddies. considering we're neighbors. But, I don't know. That sort of... That could be a weakness exploited by someone else. You know what I mean? Like, it's not necessarily that Mexico is going to do anything wrong. I don't think that the people who are migrating here from really poor, desperate situations, I don't think they're here to do anything wrong. Not at all. Not even a little bit. But at the same time, like... I don't want to use like farm animals as an analogy, but bad actors can hide among people who are fleeing desperate situations for a better life, who should have access to a better life, who should be able to, I don't know, go through a legal process by which they can enter. Because right now we don't have that, just the same as we don't have like physical barriers that Republicans want. But I'm way off here. Ukraine aid is being held up based on border security concerns. I don't know, that really sounds like a win-win to me. It does. Biden, it does not get favorable reviews or polling, I guess. Presidents on Yelp. Yeah, Biden does not score well in polling on how he handles the border. So, like, bro, this is a fucking slam dunk for you. But yeah, I don't know. Congress is out for like 3 weeks or whatever the fuck. So we'll have to wait and see what happens there. Let us move along. All right, let's get into the situation in Palestine. Oh, no. Since we were just talking about Ukraine, let's talk about Russia and what is going on in other parts of Eastern Europe. So, earlier today, the defense ministers of Germany and Lithuania signed a pretty historic agreement, and you'll see why in a second. But defense ministers Boris Pistorius and the Lithuanian man, I'm gonna fuck this up, I know I am, Arvydas Anusauskas. I'm just gonna call him Arvydas. There is going to be a brigade of soldiers in numbering at about 5,000, somewhere in that neighborhood. I think it's just under. But it's a German brigade that's going to be stationed in Lithuania at the Russian border, where they will be joining a contingent of 1,000 German troops already. But this is the historic part of this is like this is the first deployment of German troops since World War II. Holy fuck. Oh, man. So the plans, the brigade is to be combat ready by 2027, no later than. That's like a pretty fucking aggressive timetable for like 5,000 people to build a garrison for 5,000 troops and their families and all of the logistical people, support people that are coming along with them. That's a lot. The promise from Mr. Pistorius was that the troops who are, you know, forward deployed to Lithuania, they will have, like, the families of their of those troops will be, they will have, like, in the area that they're at is going to be German-centric. I would liken this for American military people, veterans or active duty, whatever, if you've been stationed overseas, you know that the place is right off base, just right off the post, right outside the gates. Those places, the people, like the waiters, waitresses, bartenders, people at restaurants that work at the stores, typically speak pretty fucking good English. That's kind of the fucking point. So this is what's going to be happening in Lithuania. They will have, the term they use was German-centric accommodations. That is to say that, like, they'll have schools, like, for their kids, where the teachers are native German speakers. The shops and everything, like, it's going to be like a little mini German town in Lithuania. You know what I mean? So why this is happening? Obviously, like I said, Russia, no shit. But the Lithuanian military, all personnel considered, every single person, both that joined of their own accord, I think they use the term professional, and then conscripts as well, they only have 16,000 personnel. This includes like their fucking Air Force, their Navy, all the rest of it. That's all they got. Right now, there's already somewhere in the neighborhood of 1,000 German troops. How many of those are like in the infantry? I'm not sure. They didn't give that breakdown. But so the 5,000 that will be there, they're leaving soon. It's just a matter of the accommodations being built up as time goes on, the timetable progresses. So the 1,000 will be folded into the new brigade, and that'll be Mr. Arvidas, the Lithuanian defense minister, the little blurb that I picked up was, we must be ready. Russia remains the main threat to us and to NATO. You love to see it. That was something that I know Trump made his supporters, who are typically super pro-military all the time about everything, like no questions asked. He had talked about withdrawing from NATO, because why? No, he said pay your bills. That was the phrase that he used to simplify the situation of the bulk of NATO members. Don't, like, they're supposed to have incremental increases in their defense spending, and the idea is that their social safety net, the strength of their social safety net, is predicated in large part for not needing to spend on defense, because the U.S. is stationed in Europe. As much as that might be true, at the same time, it's like, dude, you need to do this for yourself too. We can't just do it all for you. Germany, I know, did commit a lot to developing their self-defense force, which is now like an actual military, apparently. So there's that. They've been doing that. I know the French have a pretty solid navy and air force as well. The Brits are fucking great. But, you know, there's some of these smaller places, like, you could do more. You could be doing more. And it's not just for the sake of easement on us. It's for the sake of defense for yourselves. Like, if you had been... So Lithuania is going to be committing... The amount of money is roughly 0.3% of their GDP. But, you know, when you're a small country, like, that's a lot. So... But they're on board with this. The chair of the Parliamentary National Security and Defense Committee, the chair, Lorinus Kaskiunas. Pretty sure I got that. Little blurb here. All political parties, left to right, agree that this is a priority. We will find the resources needed. That was in response to the possibility of having to raise taxes to pay for this. I don't know, man. Like, if you guys had done this shit, oh my god, am I about to say it? Like, when Trump fucking told you to, which he wasn't the first one to say it, so don't. But man, like, that was a really highlighted moment where you could have started doing something about this, and you wouldn't be like, this is a really accelerated timeline. 3 years to build up a garrison for to house 6,000 troops and their families. Like, that's a lot. I don't doubt that you can do it. It's just, you could have done this sooner. But it's all right. At least you're doing it now. You know what I mean? That better now than trying to build up after they fucking invade. Yeah. So, which is not possible. But yeah, those are them's the breaks in NATO, our NATO allies. I fully support moving some of our troops from their fucking cozy little hovels and wherever the fuck, but move them to Lithuania, to somewhere that needs it. Alright, another European thing, real quick. This one is not like security, defense, war related. Surprise, I know. In this news comes from the Vatican. How fun. The Pope, I'm good, quote unquote, like very heavy quotes here. The Pope is allowing same-sex marriage to, and so here's the, here are the details on that, because it's not a full, I don't know, they're not offering the full sacrament of marriage, which is the ritual, the name of the ritual that they have for marriages. So they don't get the sacrament, the same-sex couples don't, but the office of the like the official interpretations of doctrine, this kind of a Supreme Court, I said kind of, you know, like that's what they do, is interpret the official word. They said that priests can administer blessings that are not part of regular church proceedings. There is a little bit here from Father James Martin. He's a Jesuit priest who does a lot of advocacy work for LGBT people as it pertains to being Catholic. So he's a big advocate for them. So that's, you know, that's really nice. But here's what he had to say. This is a major step in the church's ministry. It recognizes the deep desire in many Catholic same-sex couples for God's presence in their loving relationships. I, along with many priests, will now be delighted to bless my friends in same-sex unions. So that's really nice. Okay, so I copied and pasted this like straight, so we're going to suss out the legalese here together. All right, the document, whose Latin title is Fiducia Supplicans, Supplicating Trust is the translation there, said that the form of the blessing, quote, should not be fixed ritually by ecclesial authorities to avoid producing confusion with the blessing proper to the sacrament of marriage, end quote. Right, so it's just not part of the regular proceedings. Its application is for those who, quote, do not claim a legitimation of their own status, but who beg that all that is true, good, and humanity and humanly valid in their lives and their relationships be enriched, healed, and elevated by the presence of the Holy Spirit. So yeah, there you have it. That is the Catholic Church. You know, as I was reading that, I was thinking about it. There's an episode of South Park where they have the egg, and at that moment it was Mrs. Garrison tries to have a same-sex couple, both male and female, and that little experiment that they did on taking care of an egg was going to be that's the decision point that the governor of Colorado was going to base his same-sex marriage decision on. And at one point, he's trying to appease the crowd by saying, like, you know, instead of man and wife, you could just be butt buddies. And he just said that, like, repeated that phrase in different ways a couple of different times. And naturally, the LGBT crowd was not having it, because it's like, why? Like, the civil unions that's the joke that they were getting at. Like, what's the fuck is this? Like, if we want to be married, and if a church wants to, will, you know, do the thing for us, then why the fuck not? It's ridiculous. This to me feels like it's edging into that territory where it's just like a priest can, like, bless your marriage. It's a start. It's a start. That's all. I'm just gonna, rather than try to dig into this and try to piece it apart, it's a start. Hopefully, I hope for my LGBT brethren, sisterin, otherin, man, I hope you get, if you're Catholic, I hope you get what you are looking for. Okay, now on to Israel, Palestine. So one thing, I didn't look at the combat reports, because it's becoming too much. It hurts reading that all the time. One interesting thing, though, earlier today, the Prime Minister of the UK, Rishi Sunak, he's a Tory. That's what we would know as Republicans, conservative types. So typically, it is the position of the West that we support Israel pretty much carte blanche, and it's really stupid. But not that supporting Israel is stupid, it's not. It's the carte blanche, like, just, okay, whatever you want, we'll do that. Whatever you do is awesome. Doesn't matter what it is, you're awesome. And it's not, that doesn't jive with me. But here we go. So in a statement regarding the situation in Gaza, Mr. Sunak pointed out that too many civilians have been killed, and he was calling for a sustainable ceasefire, is the phrase that he used, in order to allow proper hostage negotiation and release. He also restated that Israel does have the right to defend itself, like, fucking duh, but it must do that in accordance with humanitarian law. Yeah, it's tough. It's a tough one. The sustainable ceasefire, it sounds, it's the same thing I pointed out previously that I heard Mrs. Tlaib say at that event I was at, where she said, okay, ceasefire, and then what? Once you get what you want, you're just going to start bombing again? Is that what's going to happen? And I'm still on board with that. Sustainable ceasefire, it sounds like the pivot that Western leaders are making before they get, so that they can avoid saying ceasefire, but they can say, you know, let's just like a sustainable ceasefire, just like a temporary humanitarian pause, like a sustainable pause, like a sustainable ceasefire. Like, shut the fuck up. Like, Sunak said in, I don't have the exact words, but that essentially expecting for there to be like some kind of ceasefire, let's say the one that happened previously, like a temporary one like that, expecting that to become permanent somehow is foolish, or like something like that. It's like, you know, it's not reasonable or possible. So there, I don't know. I'm glad to hear that Western leaders are starting to say openly that they're unhappy with what is going on, that like Biden specifically said that something about like the way that Israel is conducting itself, it's losing support on the global stage. And like, I mean, yeah, no fucking kidding. That's what we've been saying the whole fucking time. No, anybody who has any sort of idea of kicking the Israelis out on their asses, like, you're a fucking idiot. All right. But similarly, though, if you have this idea of kicking the Palestinians out, you are also a fucking idiot. Both of these people have a legitimate claim to live there. And the only reason that Israel has been able to successfully take as much land as it has is because we prop them up. But whatever. That in particular is neither here nor there. Right now, what our concern should be is the safety of non-combatants. I would like for there to be some concern and care shown for the infrastructure in Gaza, the very little that they do have. I mean, if you were to pick up just The Sims, you pick up every single person and you take them out of the Gaza Strip, and then let's just hypothetical, totally non-realistic scenario, then Israel resumes bombing the place, trying to hit Hamas, which we did not pick out because we only picked out the civilians. I don't know if I specified that, but so they start bombing again and they fucking destroy everything, and yay, Hamas is all dead. But okay, you can go home now. Like, go home to what? Rubble? I said sometime in the last release, and I'm going to say it again, that violence is not going to solve this. It won't. It's kind of weird because it's like a counterinsurgency in your own home, you know, because like Palestine, the parts that are Israel were Palestine, the parts that are Palestine should be also part of Israel. Like, they should, I say it all the time, they should be, there's no reason that they can't live together peacefully. There's no reason. I think you're like, solving this with violence is an insurgency in your own home, where you can kill 1,000 Hamas people, Hamas fighters, which, good fucking riddance. Just for every collateral damage, killed civilian that you have, you are creating more of the problem. Violence is not going to solve this. I stand by that. I've seen, been in, involved in counterinsurgency. There's really no, it's a fucking endless thing. I think there was a comic from someone like at the beginning of the global war on terror where it was like an infinity sign of the symbol and then just a spot on it that said you are here, and on the bottom says the war on terror. Like that's what you're looking at with counterinsurgency. It's not going to, you might quell the violence in the short term, but like I said, you are creating the violent actors of the future. It's an inevitability. War's a nasty business, obviously. Most of you are just witnessing it from the outside. Being in it and losing people you love in it is not good. I know that's a really stupid way of saying it, but just fuck, man, it's not good. It's just doing the exact opposite of what you want, what the outcome you want. You're doing the exact opposite. Oh, something over the weekend. Where are they? Lebanon, I think, is that. Yeah, that's where Hezbollah operates out of. But they have been, like almost the entire time, been attacking Israel from Lebanon, and Israel has decided to strike back, to which I say, good. Good fucking riddance to Hezbollah. They can eat shit with Hamas. I don't give a fuck. People like that have no place in our society. Right, speaking of Hamas, Hezbollah having no place in society, here's a fun little bit from earlier today. Their Operation Prosperity Guardian has commenced. It's a multinational task force formed to protect commercial vessels in the Red Sea. I know that I have been mentioning in the last couple releases talking about the Houthis in Yemen attacking commercial ships just for existing near Israel. Like, that's pretty fucking stupid. The Houthis can join Hezbollah and Hamas and fucking right off. The task force, it's multinational, like I said. It's going to be the US, UK, Canada, France, Italy, Netherlands, Norway, Seychelles, and Spain. Something that I thought was a good question for Secretary of Defense Lloyd Austin of the US, who announced it. I don't think this question was answered, but if those other nations are expected to do the things that we have been doing, which is to say shooting down Houthi drones or intercepting their missiles, if ships are actively under attack, are they going to actually go help them, or are they going to wait till they're fucking done shooting at them and then go help the ship that was in distress? I don't know. I would hope. I don't know what these other nations, what their navies are like. I know that they're pretty good. Like, these are really well-off, well-to-do nations. But it's just a matter of if they're authorized by their own, like, their own leadership is paramount to whatever Mr. Austin has to say. So even if he's like tells them go fucking shoot back, and they could say, yeah, sorry, Justin Trudeau said no, sorry, Rishi Sunak said no, I can't do that. So who knows, like, if they're just going to be there in a defensive capacity. That is to, oh, and a deterrence kind of thing where, yeah, the big boys are here, so you better not do anything, Houthi boys. But who knows? I like that's kind of the point of groups like the Houthis and the Hezbollah and Hamas is they don't give a shit. So we'll see. But it's something, you know. It's better. I think this is great. This is a lot better than the U.S. having to shoulder the responsibility for everything, which we often have to do. Understandably, since we have better equipment and stuff and more of it, but nonetheless, it's good to see other countries stepping up and being a part of it. There, it's wild. The amount of global commerce that is being rerouted from that area to avoid this being a potential negative consequence of being in the area. They're being rerouted around Africa, but of all of the ships and the companies that are rerouting their ships, they account for about half, just about half of the entire world's container shipments. So that's pretty fucking wild. A lot of stuff is going to be delayed as the ships cannot get to the Suez Canal. So, you know, not sure how long the delays are going to be. But if you're in the market, I've heard that oil has dipped because of the oil container ships being rerouted. So if that's your thing. Any of the shipping companies that are publicly traded are bouncing back after the reroute announcements. Just like, hey, you're not going to lose your stuff, pretty much. Some other unfortunate news. It's like a continuation. I don't recall if I talked about this one, but there was a situation in the West Bank where it's like a dozen Palestinian people were killed at a mosque. They're saying that it was like a terrorist cell, but I don't know. I don't think so. I really don't. It was not a mosque, excuse me. This is a refugee camp. I'm reading a little bit of it right now. But yeah, it was a refugee camp. And then they went to a mosque and read out Jewish prayers in the mosque. Yesterday, Sunday, the December 17th, at least five Palestinians were killed. Again, saying that it's looking for fucking terrorists in the West Bank. Like, buddy, no. The attack came from Gaza, number one. Number two, no. It's, what the fuck, man? This is exactly what I was talking about. Exactly what I was talking about. You're just creating the terrorists of tomorrow. This is exactly what you should be trying to avoid for exactly that reason. God damn it. Yeah. But, I mean, it doesn't seem like Israel has much regard. Like, it's pretty obvious that they don't care. There was a situation. There was a school building where a family and a lot of people taking refuge there. Some Israeli troops burst into the space, and they just started killing people, just shooting at everything, everyone. It's hard to read. At least 9 people were killed at the time, some of which were children. It feels, there's a joke that we have, that I have with among some buddies, that it's something, somebody says something really distressing. It doesn't necessarily have to be true for the purposes of the setup, but the reply is like looking into this, which it's a reference to pretty much any time somebody tells Elon Musk about some crazy shit happening on Twitter that shouldn't be happening. That's all he says is looking into it. I'm looking into this, working on it. And that this school shooting where a man, his children and grandchildren were all murdered in front of him. And when he tried to leave the room, the soldiers told him to stay, that you cannot leave. And when it was brought up to the Israeli military, that's all they said was, we're working on it. Like, what the dude, what are you working on? This isn't something that you fucking work on right now. This is something that is trained, like, they're taught to behave this way. I mean, the soldiers were taught to behave this way. They're not either that or they're fucking psychopaths. Either way, it's not good. So, I'm not sure what you're working on exactly. The count, casualty count is around 20,000 now. Most of that has been from the bombing that I discussed. I think it was last week, where dumb bombs were smart bombs, you know? Yeah, so a lot of it is from that. So wonderful, isn't that great? All of this comes in the face. Wow, that's a weird phrase. It flies in the face of all of this wanton destruction and killing and maiming, hurting, wounding, destroying people, and all the hospitals are fucked. The whatever the little bit of hospital that they did have anyway is completely fucked. The one, I think they have one running hospital, and it's the description that I have of it here that I'm looking at is just, it's just one word, and it's bloodbath. It's a fucking bloodbath. People are coming in droves. Droves. And very few people that can help. Very few supplies with which to help. And all of these horrible injuries that have to be treated, like there's no pain relief, there's no medication to dull the pain for them, and so they're just sitting there in agony. The other hospital, I'm sure if you're keeping up with this, you recall that the Israelis claimed that Hamas was operating in and underneath it. And when they went in to look, they took pictures of Arabic lettering on the wall and said, look, it's a fucking terrorist schedule. And then somebody was pointed out, like, those are just the days of the week. What the fuck are you talking about? So that hospital, it's being occupied right now by Israeli forces. The bottom floor was completely destroyed with a bulldozer. So that's fun. That's one hospital down. I think that's the point. Last thing before we get out of here, and I'm sure that you all heard this one because it was big, big news. the three Israeli hostages that they were trying to get back to Israel, and they had white cloth, like a flag. They had signs painted on cloth that they used, I think it was food or like makeup or something. I don't know, some shit that they found. And like it said, help, like please help us, we're hostages. And it was written in Hebrew. So that's kind of weird that three of them, they were killed, all three of them, by the Israeli soldiers. In a statement from General Staff Major General Herzi Halevi, he said, quote, what if it is two Gazans with a white flag coming out to surrender? Do we shoot them? Absolutely not. Even those who are fighting us, if they lay down their arms and raise their hands, we arrest them. We don't shoot them. End quote. Does not seem to be the case. It does not seem to be the case. Fuck, 20,000 people dead. Fuck. I don't want to keep going. Like, this is really difficult. All right, as we get out of here, let's do the wrap up. Other shows on Lux Media, if you go to lvxmedia.net, that's where you can find everything. We have sports shows, fucking new age mystical stuff, whatever, most anything you fancy, we do have or will have something to entertain you. Internet, so doing the internet stuff. So on that website, you can go to the Progressive Patriots page. So it's lvxmedia.net, hit the Progressive Patriots button, or go to progressivepatriots.us if you prefer. And there will be two contact options. It's a phone number that you can call or text anonymously. If you call it, you're just leaving a voicemail. No one's picking up. If you want to email, you can do that. I would love to hear. If I said something, you know, by mistaken on what I said, I have no problem correcting myself, correcting the record. I do not want to give false information, intentionally or otherwise. Social media, you can find all of it on LVXMediaNet. That's the name. If you can't find me, I'm not on it. Let's see. If you want to get involved with something like with a group that helps to push change for the better with situations like these and in the US as well, it's called Common Defense. That's the name of the group. You can check it out. Go to lvx.at/cdef. lvx.at/cdef. It's Common Defense. If you get signed up there, whoever it is you get in touch with, let them know I sent you. All right. So we did talk about Palestine. So I looked into an organization, a charitable organization that they're really great. They were vetted by another podcast group that is far more well equipped than I am, but I looked into it as well. It's solid. It's based out of the UK. It's MAP. It's Medical Aid for Palestinians. And that's lvx.at/map. That's how you can get there. If you can give something, please do. Like I described to you, like these people are in desperate need. I have other ones. We did talk a little bit about Ukraine. LVX.at/Ukraine. That group that I linked, that is linked to that, they will, they're non-government, and they help non-combatants. They just want to help people who have nothing to do with this bullshit. And that's it. I described last week the horrors, absolute horrors, going on in Sudan. It's rough. If you can handle that, definitely go check it out, what I described, what's going on. It's pretty rough. If you want to help there, it's lvx.at/Sudan. Easy. There is a very similar crisis going on in the Congo, lvx.at/Congo. Yeah, just kind of see what I'm doing there. And we also talked about the earthquake that was in, northeast Afghanistan. And it displaced like hundreds of thousands of people. And now they're freezing out in the desert because they don't have anywhere to go. Getting aid there is difficult, but I was able to find a group that's pretty good. As much as I've been able to look into them, that I've gathered, they're not working through the Taliban, who skims like fucking 80% off the top of everything or whatever. But yeah, so this one is lvx.at/Afghan, A-F-G-H-A-N. So there you go. Those are all the fucking shits listed. All the aid, the charitable groups that I've looked into that are good, doing good work. I don't think we have anything else. All of this shit that you hear from whoever you hear from, it should be troubling you. It should be difficult. And if it gets to the point where it's not, that's a problem. If hearing these things doesn't bother you, doesn't matter where it is, doesn't matter what they look like, doesn't matter what fucking book they read before they pray or whatever, that fucking doesn't matter. Be kind to people. Be kind to each other. Be kind to yourself. This is all we got, so let's try to make it a little less shitty for the people who are dealt a bad hand. Yeah. If you want to contact me, I already said, you can go to the page, but the number, I just... muscle memory, I guess. 833-589-7637. 833-LUX-PODS. All right, well, we will catch you tomorrow for the domestic